Good morning, students. In the previous video, we had discussed about the three main characters who worked in the Gemini studio. That is the office boy, Kotha Mangalam Subbu, and the legal advisor. Through this chapter, the narrator gives an interesting portrait of these leading characters. He talks about their talent, roles, ambitions, and frustrations. The writer through these characters gives a voice to every individual who migrate to the cities with a big ambition, but unfortunately, the ambitions and dreams goes lost somewhere in the world of glamour and sophistication. The office boy is one such example. There's a sharp contrast between the three characters, as all of them have their own stories to tell. Now let's read further in the chapter. While every other member of the department wore a kind of uniform khadi dhoti with a slightly oversized and clumsily tailored white khadi shirt, the legal advisor wore pants and a tie and sometimes a coat that looked like a coat of mail. So the narrator says that every member of the department wore a khadi, particularly khadi dhoti. Khadi, as we all know, is an Indian woven fabric. So they were all dressed in an Indian traditional attire, which was slightly oversized. That means it was of loose fitting and clumsily tailored. Clumsily tailored means roughly stitched. Whereas the legal advisor, on the other hand, was dressed in a Western formal style. So as he wore a pant and a tie, which sometimes looked like a coat of mail. So coat of mail means armor or a shield. You might have seen the soldiers before they go on the war. In the historical time, they used to wear armor in order to protect themselves. So the narrator uses this simile to reflect the idea that the advisor looked more like an armored soldier whenever he used to dress in Western formal style. Often he looked alone and helpless, a man of cold logic in a crowd of dreamers, a neutral man in an assembly of Gandhites and Khadites. So the narrator brings out the caricature of the legal advisor and says that he remained isolated and looked helpless, unlike Subbu, which we have already read in our previous video. So unlike Subbu, he did not have any company. He was not very friendly to others. He was a man of cold logic in a crowd of dreamers, which means he failed to consider human factors such as culture, rituals, and social dynamics, etc. He remained neutral when people supported the vision of Gandhites and Khadites. This somewhere reflects that the society was divided and run on the beliefs and principles of their favorite political leaders. Like so many of those who were close to the boss, he was allowed to produce a film, and though a lot of raw stock and pancake were used on it, not much came of the film. So those members who were in the good books of the boss or were close to the boss, and so was our advisor as well, they got the chance to produce film, and a lot of raw stock and pancake was used in the making of the film, but unfortunately the film was not a big success. Then one day, the boss closed down the story department, and this was perhaps the only instance in all human history where a lawyer lost his job because the poets were asked to go home. One day it so happened that the story department had to shut down, though the narrator does not mention the reason why. So in a sarcastic manner, he says that due to this crisis, the lawyer lost his job and the entire creative team that worked in the Gemini studio had to also resign. Gemini Studios was a favorite haunt of poets like S.D.S. Yogiyar, Sambhu Subramanyam, Krishna Shastri and Haridranath Chattopadhyay. The narrator says that famous poets and thinkers often used to visit this studio. In other words, Gemini Studio was the hub of creative people and writers. It had an excellent mess which supplied good coffee at all times of the day and for most part of the night. So this Gemini Studio provided an excellent coffee for its workers and also for those who worked late at night. Those were the days when Congress rule meant prohibition and meeting over a cup of coffee was rather satisfying entertainment. The narrator speaks about the social milieu under the Congress rule. There was complete restriction, but this place, cafeteria, served to give relaxation where people could sit and laugh and spend their leisure with their acquaintances. Bearing the office boys and a couple of clerks, everybody else at the studios radiated leisure, a prerequisite for poetry. Most of them wore khadi and worshipped Gandhiji, but beyond that, they had not the faintest appreciation for political thought of any kind. So except the office boys and the few clerks who worked in the Jammu studio, the rest all seemed to radiate leisure. Radiated leisure means optimizing the free time. They utilized their free time. So they would sit in the cafeteria and discuss about their writings and about their poetry as if it was a necessary thing to do. Whereas these office boys and few clerks who worked there in the Jammu studio were always pressurized and were always burdened with works. So the narrator indirectly reflects the miserable condition of the office boys and those who did menial jobs at the studio. So he says that they remain aloof and away from the observance and frolics. So most of the members wore khadi and like Gandhiji's ideology, but they did not have any such inclination towards politics or supported any political party in particular. This clearly reflects that they had an aversion to communism. What does communism mean? So communism means the ideology based in opposition to liberal democracy and capitalism. So according to them, they had believed that the one who followed communist ideals were not very social and had no family life. A communist was a godless man. He had no filial or conjugal love. He had no compunction about killing his own parents or his children. He was always out to cause and spread unrest and violence among innocent and ignorant people. So the narrative explains that the communists were a godless man, which means that heartless and had no sentiments or love towards their family. So a person who believed in the communist ideals had no compunction, means reluctance, that they killed their own children or parents. All they knew was how to spread unrest and violence in the society in general, or in particular, we can say that they were a very volatile or volatile attitude. Such notions, which prevailed everywhere else in the South India at that time, also naturally floated about vaguely among the khadi-clad poets of Jammu studio. Evidence of it was soon forthcoming. So the people, those who worked in the Jammu studios, also had the same perception and belief about this communist party. And those khadi poets, particularly those who were influenced by the Gandhi, hated communism, and its consequence was to be soon experienced. When Frank Buchman's model rearmament army, some 200 strong, visited Madras sometime in 1952, they could not have found a warmer host in India than the Jammu studio. Someone called the group an international circus. So this Frank Buchman's Moral Rearmament Army was a spiritual and moral movement that started in the year 1952, and they came to India to stage their shows, and Jammu studio all-heartedly welcomed the troupe. Some of them considered the group as international circus. They weren't very good on the trapeze, and their acquaintance with animal was only at the dinner table, but they presented two plays in a most professional manner. The performers were not good at trapezium or with animals. So the narrator mocks at this situation and says that their love for animal could only be seen on the dinner table. That means they were all non-vegetarian. Rest all what they did in their show was only a show-off. The Jodham Valley and the Forgotten Factor ran several shows in Madras, and along with the other citizens of the city, the Jammu family of 600 saw the plays over and over again. So the two plays were a great success and ran with several shows in Madras and was widely applauded by the people of South audience and had many repetition of the show. The message of the plays were usually plain and simple, homelies, but the sets and costumes were first rate. Madras and Tamil drama community were terribly impressed, and for some years almost all Tamil plays had a scene of sunrise and sunset in the manner of Jodham Valley, with a bare stage and a white background curtain and a tune played on the flute. So the narrator says that the message conveyed by these white people in their show was very straight and simple. They were mostly in form of sermons and philosophy, the entire Madras community was so impressed that they performed the scene of sunrise and the sunsets in the same manner, as they did in their show, and the artists of the Gemini Studios were quite impressed by their presentation. It was some years later that I learned that the MRA was a kind of counter movement to international communism, and the big bosses of Madras like Mr. Vasan simply played into their hands. I'm not sure, however, that this was indeed the case or the unchangeable aspects of these big bosses and their enterprises remained the same, MRA or no MRA, international communism or no international communism. So of late the narrator realized that the MRA was opposed to communism, or they were against the ideas of communism, and people like Mr. Vasan, who was the founder of the Gemini Studio, were suffering at their hands. However, their business remained unaffected by such issues. The staff of the Gemini Studios had a nice time hosting 200 people of all hues and sizes of at least 20 nationalities. It was such a change from the usual collection of crowd players waiting to be slapped with the thick layers of makeup by the office boy in the makeup department. So not only the audience but also the staff, those who were working in the Gemini Studio, had a nice time as they had something unusual to do. So they were happy to host 200 people that came from 20 different countries. It was quite different from their usual routine of crowd shooting, where the characters had to be painted with thick layers of makeup by the office boy. A few months later, the telephone lines of the big bosses of Madras buzzed, and once again we at the Gemini Studios cleared the whole shooting stage to welcome another visitor. So after a few months, there were calls for appointment as the Gemini Studios got many proposals to host shows from foreign lands. So they had to cancel or postpone all the current shooting and were ready to welcome the group. All they said was that he was a poet from England, the only poet from England the simple Gemini staff knew or heard of were Wordsworth and Tennyson. The more literate ones knew of Keats, Shelley and Byron, and one or two might have faintly come to know of someone by the name Eliot, who was the poet visiting the Gemini Studios now. So all they knew that there was poet from England who was going to visit the studio. However, the staff of the Gemini Studio were very simple and were not literary enthusiasts. All these years they have only heard about Wordsworth and Tennyson. So those who had little knowledge or have had little inclination towards literature knew about Keats, Shelley, Byron and Eliot. So they were quite curious to know who was their new visitor.